Mars has, of course, been in the skies for longer than there have been humans on Earth to observe it. But in all that time, ours is the first generation to achieve the capability to send spacecraft across the millions of miles between us and Mars, to go into orbit around the planet, to take photographs of it, and even to land on it. Today's report will consist primarily of imagery returned to the Earth by the Mars Global Surveyor spacecraft that went into orbit in 1990 around Mars and still has the ability to take high-resolution images. High-resolution means that it can, that the single elements within any one image, that called pixels, the smallest possible box within that image corresponds to a width on the ground of anywhere between 1.5 and 5 meters. So to calibrate that a bit, it means that you could see things the size of buildings. You could see things, if you were photographing Earth at that revolution, you'd be able to see motor vehicles moving around. You could even theoretically see a person, although it would be just a single pixel, or if you stretched out, maybe two. So there would be no resolution. But that's the kind of resolution we have in these images. These are all images from the spacecraft, so they're official NASA images. And they are all available on public domain official NASA websites. Now, the portions I'll be showing you today are extracted from the original images to concentrate on the area that interests us, and they have been processed. Now, I should explain very carefully what that means. Just as when you use a camera, you set the length of exposure, you focus it, and so on, you do settings to make it appear more reasonable to what the human eye would like to see. We do the same thing with spacecraft images. That's because the spacecraft camera has a much wider range of brightnesses that it's sensitive to than the human eye and contrast that it's sensitive to. So it's necessary to bring those within the range that the human eye can perceive so that the images we look at are more closely resemble what the human eye would see if actually present at Mars. And so when we use the computer to globally adjust an image in brightness and contrast, we are simply bringing it into the range of human vision, and we are not in any way changing the content of that image. You could selectively apply brightness and contrast to individual parts of an image. That would be cheating, and that could change the overall appearance. We haven't done that. These are just global changes, the kind that are generally recognized in image processing as what is necessary to bring it into human vision range. Moreover, the general character of the things that we'll be seeing have been selected out of over 100,000 high-resolution strips from Mars as ones that in some way impressed us as anomalous or generally of the character that if they had been images taken of the Earth from orbit, there would be little cause to doubt, or the leading explanation would be human activity. But of course, these are pictures taken of Mars, and so there's a great deal of controversy about whether what is the simplest explanation and whether the idea of artificiality, the intelligent activity, is even allowed in that sequence, or is it to remain forever an extraordinary hypothesis? Well, I'll spend the first little bit of this presentation laying the background for that, because if we can show to a reasonable certainty that just one image or just one artifact, potential artifact on Mars, really is artificial, that is made by intelligence rather than natural, a product of nature, if we can just do that once, then that makes the interpretation of anything else on Mars as artificial no longer extraordinary. So that means that not every image we show has to stand on its own 2 feet as definitely artificial. It means if we can just do that for one image, then artificiality is allowed on the list of possible explanations for anything else we see, because it's no longer extraordinary if you've shown it once.
I'll show just this one slide by way of making a connection, the significance of which will become more apparent near the end. Alan Alford alluded to the exploded planet hypothesis, an idea that dates back to the very discovery of the asteroid belt, thousands of pieces of what may be debris or maybe a planet that never formed between Mars and Jupiter. There is a lot of evidence that that there was a planet that exploded. My book contains 5 chapters summarizing this evidence in many different categories. As Mars relates to this, the evidence indicates that the role of Mars was not as an original planet, but as a moon of a planet that exploded. The planet itself probably disappeared from the solar system several million years ago, and Mars was in orbit at that time, possibly along with another moon. And Mars would have been right there at the time of the explosion. So as you would expect, if Mars was sitting close to a planet that exploded, there would be quite a bit of evidence of that. And there does seem to be. There are many mysteries about Mars, one of which, the most striking, now that we've seen it close up with spacecraft, is that Mars is almost like two planets, two halves of a sphere, pasted together. One hemisphere of Mars is strongly cratered on one side. It is saturated with craters on one side, and quite smooth and relatively craterless on the other. On the cratered side, the thickness of the crust of Mars gradually increases toward the center up to over 20 kilometers. And on the uncratered half, it's a smooth, flat, 1 kilometer thick. It is the flattest known surface in the whole solar system, other than for this odd cratered hemisphere. The geographic or spin pole, not the magnetic pole, the spin pole of Mars is known by planetary geologists, nothing to do with exploded planets or the story I'll be telling you tonight. Just straight planetary geologists discovered evidence that the spin pole of Mars changed drastically at least once, possibly twice in the past, and that it tipped as much as 90 degrees rather suddenly, because there is no evidence of intermediate pole positions. The tie-in with what I was alluding to, the being in the face of the explosion, is that if you explode a moon that's in synchronous orbit, keeping one face toward the planet, and put all this extra mass on one side of it, just as if you put a weight on a spinning top, it's going to tip over and the spin axis is going to go through where the extra weight is. So that's what you would expect to happen to a planet that was near a major explosion. The original dense atmosphere of Mars, for which there's plenty of evidence that it was once thicker than Earth's present atmosphere, is now mostly gone. The present atmosphere is only 1% of Earth's, nearly a vacuum. And there are on a list of over 24 items, I've just mentioned these highlights. There's xenon-129 detected in the atmosphere of Mars, which is a fission byproduct requiring a massive explosion, and there's an excess of it on Mars more than is seen elsewhere in the solar system. In this first section, we'll deal with the issue of artificial versus natural images. This is an overview of the region of Mars called Cydonia. It's drawn a lot of attention. It's just an area about 15 or 20 miles on the side, relatively small section of the whole planet, the size of a major metropolitan city these days. But its most famous feature is the one up here, which is the so-called face on Mars. And many of the other features, in fact, to some extent, all of them are anomalous in some ways and unique. Names have been given to these features. I'm not going to show very many of them in high resolution. This is the famous fortress feature. This little group of pyramidal-like objects with mounds is called the city complex. There's a feature just off the screen down here called the D&M pyramid, and so on. The object that is called the face up here is the one I'll discuss for a moment. It's received the most press, good and bad, mostly bad of late. It attracted attention in 1976 as looking just a wee bit more like the impression of a face than you might expect to see in clouds and in mountains. But once you see an image like this, there's no way to be sure from, no matter what it looks like, whether it's artificial or natural. All you can do when you find your first image is form hypotheses and make predictions. If it's natural, then this would follow. If it's artificial, then that would follow. And then in the future, perform those tests and see. Well, there were, when this was determined, the group of independent scientists who study these matters came up with 8 tests that they could think of. And they eventually conducted those tests, and 5 of them came out in favor of artificiality, and 3 of them came out in favor of natural origin. 2 of those 8 tests, this was in the initial run. Later on, 1 more of the tests, which was whether the invisible shadowed side was symmetric with the visible side and had another eye socket and the mouth going through, also came out in favor of artificiality. 2 of the tests that came out natural origin were tests I proposed myself. I said that if this were built to look like a humanoid face, since it can't be seen at all that way from the ground, it has to be viewed from above. So at the very least, you'd have built it upright. You wouldn't build something intended to look like a face and put it over on its side or tipped at any angle. And as you see, it's tipped at a considerable angle here. And also, you would have probably put it in a conspicuous and culturally meaningful place such as the equator so you could see it from any approach direction. But at 41 degrees north latitude, it was neither of those. It appeared to be random and artificial. I kind of had to eat my words in 1976. Up to that point, I had been an advocate for keeping an open mind, not taking a position. The well-known Richard Hoagland, an advocate of artificiality, had expressed a willingness to bet me at 100-1 odds that this would turn out to be an artificial object. Built by intelligence. And I was in a discussion one day on the internet, again defending the idea that we should keep an open mind till the evidence is in, and one of the conventional astronomers spontaneously offered to bet me or anyone at 100-1 odds that this was a natural object. Well, no, recognizing an opportunity when I see one, I pointed out that for every dollar I bet both ways, I'm $99 richer no matter what is the case. But this this to me was an object lesson in not letting your emotions dictate your views. Clearly somebody was not being objective here, at least one of the two sides. But in December 96, I was on a radio program discussing why Comet Hale-Bopp did not have a companion, and the origin of comets. And I mentioned the exploded planet hypothesis and how the most recent such explosion apparently took place 3.2 million years ago. And a caller, or listener rather, wrote me email, and he asked a very interesting question. He said, if you're right about all that, there's this area on Mars called Cydonia, and it has this famous face in it. And if that thing is artificial, it had to have builders. And maybe that explosion event you talked about 3.2 million years ago was what did in the builder's civilization. And he said, you also mentioned a pole shift, which would have happened at that right at that time of that explosion, which meant, by this line of reasoning, the face had to be built before the pole shift. And he said, so where was the face on Mars before the pole shift? And I thought that was a very interesting question, and I understood its significance immediately. So I went to my globe of Mars, and I put my thumb on Cydonia, and I put my finger on the last known position of the Mars geographic pole before the present one. And as nearly as I could rough it out by eye, it was roughly 90 degrees. So I said, well, darn, I'll have to calculate this out. So I plugged in the coordinates in the computer, calculated the angle between the old pole and the present face on Mars, came out 90.1 degrees. That's an interesting angle. That means it's right on the old equator. Well, I contained my excitement for a moment. I said, wait a minute, there's another part to this test. It also has to be upright with respect to the old equator. And I've drawn the old equator in here with the white line. And as you can see, the face is indeed quite upright with respect to it also. In fact, it's within 2 degrees. So both of my tests now registered artificial, if you follow this line of reasoning, that it was merely built before the last catastrophe. This was a bit of a shock to my system, because I appreciated the fact, one, that the odds were 1,000 to 1 against that being an accident, and two, that even though I was very uncomfortable going there, that the intellectually honest thing to do was to say I was no longer justified in sitting on the fence, but had to say that there was now reason to suspect artificiality in the face on Mars, such that it ought to be a priority for future imaging. Several members of the Society for Planetary Study Research, SPSR, had reached that conclusion also, and they approached NASA in December 1997 and got them to agree to giving priority to re-imaging the face with the spacecraft in high resolution. This is computer-enhanced version of the original 1976 Viking image, essentially the same image I just showed you, but with computers used to bring out details in the shadowed side. And you can see, even in this medium resolution image, there is a second eye socket and the mouth does go through. There's something asymmetric over here, but the enclosure or the shape of the mesa itself is remarkably linear and symmetric. Based on the strength of this image, we made some predictions that at the time we really thought we were just doing pro forma. None of us took them nearly as seriously as we should have in hindsight, but we said, well, if this is a natural object, then as we view it in higher resolution, it's going to look more natural. On the other hand, if this was built to represent a humanoid face, faces have more than eye sockets, noses, and a black line under the nose for a mouth. There's more detail. There would be eyebrows over the eye socket, irises in the eye socket. The nose would have nostrils at the end of it. The mouth would consist of separate parted lips. And so on. There are other details to the face. And moreover, that these secondary facial features have to occur just in the right location, have the right size, the right shape, and the right orientation to be obvious intents to portray what secondary facial features, and nowhere else on the mesa, so that you can just pick and choose the one that fits the mind's preconception of a face. That seemed like a hard enough condition to meet, and in fact, the odds against meeting it were enormous meeting it by chance. In fact, that it is in scientific method how we tell the difference between a legitimate statistic or a finding that we have to trust and one that merely allows us to form hypotheses to go forward. In science, we formally call this the a priori principle. It basically means what you stumble upon and see after the fact, a posteriori, doesn't count. You just use it to form hypotheses. What you predict before you have any clue what the correct answer is a priori, and that you have to take seriously if it comes out. So the a priori principle is that the odds of something arising by chance are significant if calculated before any evidence of its existence is known, and a posteriori, the opposite, the calculated odds of something already found arising by chance really apply only to the next instance. That's because lots of million-to-one, billion-to-one, even trillion-to-one coincidences can and do occur in nature, and they're found all over the place. Accidents do happen. In fact, part of randomness includes regularity. If something were claimed to be a random data set and it didn't have some regular patterns in it, it wouldn't truly be random. Just to give one illustration I sometimes use to bring out this point, if you had a deck of 52 cards and deal them out amongst four players, say, to play bridge, each player gets 13 cards. There are 13 cards in each suit. So take spades, for example. If if you've been dealt 13 cards and you pick them up and they're all spades, you're going to say, wow, this is a very unusual hand. In fact, the odds against being dealt all 13 spades, the only 13 in the deck, are 635 billion to 1 against. So you say, well, I just got all spades. Can I conclude then that the deck was fixed or there's been some cheating here? Well, maybe so. You could have your suspicions, but no, you couldn't prove that because, as a matter of fact, every single deal you get of 13 unique cards, the odds against getting those particular unique cards are also 635 billion to 1. And if you'd specified them in advance, that would be the odds against getting that deal. So every deal that you get is a miracle at 635 billion to 1. Contrast then the case where you pick up the hand, you see all spades, and you wonder. Versus on the other hand, let's say I sit down at the table and I say, you haven't dealt those cards yet, but I predict that I'm going to get all 13 spades when I pick up my hand. Then the cards are dealt, I pick up my hand and I have all 13 spades. You can be very sure that was no accident. So that's the difference between the a priori and the a posteriori. So when something is predicted in advance, as these secondary facial features on Mars were, can be considered significant. The predictions were specifically eyebrow, nostrils, iris, and lips with the correct size, shape, location, and orientation. We worked out the odds against each of one of those occurring by accident and then combined them all together. And then, except for the iris shape, a circle, no similar features exist in the background that would allow us to pick and choose. So then this is the spacecraft image, the actual data as it came down from the spacecraft. Now, this may not bear much resemblance to images you've seen in the media, and I'll explain that difference in a moment, but this is the actual spacecraft data. Now, this image was taken under very unfavorable conditions. Specifically, the spacecraft was not over the mesa at all. It was far off to the west, so it was looking at the face not quite edge-on, but so nearly that this is more closer to a profile of half a face than of a full face. So you see that the left eye socket is this huge area here, and the right eye socket, we can just see the far corner. It's hidden behind the nose ridge. That's because of our very slanted angled viewing perspective. We're viewing from the side, not above. And the other thing is that the lighting was extremely unfavorable. Basically, the sunlight is coming from down in this direction. And as you know, if you hold a flashlight under your chin, a human face looks rather distorted and almost grotesque when illuminated in that way. So the lighting conditions were unfavorable to seeing this what might be there also. Nonetheless, we were startled to see that over the west side eye socket, there was a triangular feature that could conceivably be a sculpture's attempt to represent an eyebrow, that in the eye socket there is a circular feature that could be an attempt to portray an iris, that at the end of the nose there are two circular features that could be attempts to portray nostrils, and that the mouth feature did indeed consist of parted lips. When we put all this together skilled computer graphics artists worked on this, and their expertise is such that they were very, very careful in doing what I'm going to show you now. They were very careful not to do anything to this image that would in any way change the content of the image, but only change the viewer's perspective of it. So specifically, the artist simply attempted to use the computer. This is a standard feature built into image processing programs such as Adobe Photoshop. Any of you can purchase on the market. You can change the lighting, the direction from which the lighting comes for a feature, and you can change the angle at which you're viewing it. Now, that requires knowing three-dimensional information about the image, but we have that because we have images from the face taken at several different viewing angles. This is what the artist began with a negative of the image I just showed you. And let's see. Now, if I can, what I'm going to do is start this animation. It's a very short animation. It'll be over before you blink an eye. This is just a sequence of images put together in an animation that show the lighting change being made step by step, very quickly, and then show the reorientation of the face to an overhead viewing angle. So here it goes. There's the lighting change, and there's the adjustment to the overhead viewing angle. And this is the computer's reconstruction of what it would have looked like from that viewing angle. Now, this is the image that was released to the media. It doesn't even look anything like the original raw data. What happened here? Well, that's a very good question. Fortunately, this is not part of a conspiracy or anything that the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, the JPL, that runs the spacecraft for NASA can be faulted on in the sense of engaging in any kind of cover-up, because they have placed on their website the original raw data for the spacecraft and this image and the exact recipe used to get from one to the other. They don't say why they did this, but they do explain exactly how it was done. The answer is that from the raw spacecraft data to get here, we pass the raw image through a high-pass filter, then pass it separately through a low-pass filter, and then average those two images. Well, each filter takes out quite a bit of detail, and then when you average them, that smooths it out even more. And when they released this image, it was accompanied by a lot of verbiage to the effect of, obviously, this is a pile of rocks, and that's really a joke that anyone would take this seriously, which is not very scientific. Here from Adobe Photoshop is the exact definition of a high-pass filter to give you an idea of what they were doing when they did this. Retains edge details where sharp color transitions occur and suppresses the rest of the image. The filter removes low-frequency detail in an image, useful for extracting line art and large black and white areas from scanned images. What business do they have applying that filter to this object? I think that the answer is they didn't really have any legitimate business doing that, but as nearly as I've been able to piece together the story from colleagues and from my knowledge of the way it works inside JPL. I spent 3 months there a couple of decades ago as a consultant. The image was shipped up to the JPL image processing lab, which probably put it through every image processing trick they knew, including every filter they knew, just to see how things looked and what detail it could bring out. Then along came the JPL Public Information Office, which had the mission, and I'll give them the benefit of the doubt, they probably thought they were doing the right thing, because to quote the astronomer in charge of the spacecraft imagery, Michael Malin, and this is his message to the astronomers when he presented this image, he said that his team and he personally resented being ordered to take the image because it was a slap at the integrity of the scientists involved and a waste of public funds. That was their viewpoint going in before the image was taken, and they were resentful of it. And I think that thinking they were doing the right thing by putting this down so that the public didn't get the wrong idea that there might be something here worth pursuing, the Public Information Office came in, looked over the images, and said, we see the one we want that'll give the right impression. This will kill the story. And, of course, they released that, and it did kill the story. I think it was not for conspiratorial reasons, but for out of a belief they were doing the right thing. But God save us from people who think they're doing the right thing for us. The astronomers' conclusions regarding the face, and I'll own up to these for myself, because although some of the members of the independent scientists, the SPSR group, sign on for with these, some are not as convinced as these results would indicate. But when we combine the odds against all those a priori predictions, the natural origin hypothesis is disproved at odds of 1,000 billion billion to 1. Now, that's a formal number, but it's an indication of the strength of the a priori hypothesis, which, by the way, is ordinarily used to rule out hypotheses. And you can believe it was a shock to all of us when, in this case, it was the natural origin hypothesis that got ruled out. Now, that still leaves some other possibilities besides artificiality on Mars, one of which is that it was some reverse conspiracy at JPL, or as some would have it these days, that the whole space program is a fake. Ruling out all hypotheses which have long odds against them, the artificiality of Cydonia would seem to be the most reasonable interpretation of what we have here, and I've said, for speaking for myself, beyond a reasonable doubt.
The chances of anything coming from Mars are million to one, he said. Of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, but still they come.
Seemed an appropriate musical selection for that point. I also like this quote from Stephen Goldberg: "The consequences of a claim that something is true are entirely irrelevant to the issue of whether the claim is true." In our next section here, first let me do the title slide. I call this section Special Shapes. Let me back up. This is the only image that is not of Mars. In this presentation. Back in the days of the lunar orbiter in the late 60s and early 70s, an image was taken that showed this Yukert crater. It was a low-resolution image, but it was curious because it's a crater very near the center of the side of the moon that continually faces Earth, and it seemed to have a triangular interior, leading to speculation that this is where the UFO base was and they were monitoring the Earth from there. But later, when the Clementine spacecraft went by and took a high-resolution view, we saw that the sides were really not particularly linear, that the apexes were not particularly angular, and that this could be understood, too, as just pressure waves from nearby impacts pushing in the sides and forming a very crudely triangular shape in the interior. Crude is the operative word here. Yet this is the best closed triangle anywhere in the solar system, Earth and Mars excepted. By contrast, on Mars, we have hundreds of triangles much better than Euchre. Here is one that I'm showing you, just a sample of many of its class. Curiously, a regular feature is that there's a crater at one apex of these triangles. Here's a raised triangle, very odd to have a plateau in the shape of a triangle. Here's a curious set of embedded triangles, an inner set, another set. I'm sure you can still make out this one. A little too dim for this reproduction system is there are two more levels of triangles, all with a common apex, six embedded triangles in all that we've been able to trace, and a crater again at the apex of this triangle. Not only triangular shapes, but pyramid shapes too, four and five-sided. This is the DMN pyramid in the medium resolution Viking images. Remarkably triangular faces on this fellow. And subsequently we're able to bring out some detail in the shadowed side. This is an Odyssey image showing this odd feature over here. And in high resolution, the Global Surveyor showed what almost looks temptingly to say looks like an entranceway on the back side of that pyramid. Never mind the association, which is much too speculative, this object is certainly one we'll want to have a close-up look at when we have ground truth capability. This is, looking at the image on the left here for a moment, this is a wide-field, low-resolution view of an area of Mars that has some curious angular-looking features all lined up in an L shape. Rather regular, non-random distribution. This white box here is an outline of where the Mars Global Surveyor came by and took a high-resolution view. Even though there are 100,000 of these high-resolution strip images just like this one, Mars is a big place, and we've only photographed 0.1% of the surface of Mars at high resolution. Notice that this high-resolution image just goes over part of one of these blocks, whatever they are. And here it is here in the high-resolution view. This is just that block part of that image. It looks rather pyramidal with nice angular triangular faces. Well, I don't have to tell you that if you randomly select, and it was randomly selected, one object out of a field of objects that look rather angular, and it turns out to be a nice pyramid. What are we to make of the others? We'll be anxious to see someday. But as the title there suggests, it may be quite an interesting field of objects. And if there are small enclosures in them with manuscripts, as Alan Alford suggests, wouldn't we like to read those? here are some interesting craters. Unusual because they're relatively high, sharply flat-bottomed with high rims and flat tops to the rims, and a very unusual raised feature, teardrop shape feature in the interior. There is probably no other feature quite like this anywhere in the solar system, except another crater about 10 kilometers away, shown in the inset down here, which has an almost identical raised feature, and it's virtual twin. Look how flat top that crater is, and how steep the division between the base, the flat floor, which you can tell is flat by the uniformness of the gray, and the steep walls. Spacecraft is viewing this at a slight angle. You could go skateboarding around the top of that crater. It's so flat. And the identity of these objects is remarkable. Here's some very other unusual shapes. We'd love to know what this object is, the size of a... the crater itself is about a kilometer across. This is hundreds of meters in diameter, bigger than this auditorium. It's not a golf ball that got stuck in the pit. This looks like a shatter pattern, the kind you usually only get in crystals, ice, or glass. What's it doing on Mars in an area where there's no ice clearly present? Very unusual shape here, rectangular, circular center, arrow-shaped tip. And look at the shadow it casts, stair-step shape. Here's a group of odd white stripes in a caterpillar shape. Very unusual features that seem worthy of note. This can be seen either as channels or as raised. The correct interpretation is channels because the sunlight is coming from this direction. If you're getting the opposite view, if you work on it, it's possible to flip them. If not, you just need to invert the image and you'll get the opposite view. A lot of these images have raised or depth ambiguities, and you have to know where the sun is to resolve that. But if that's a water-carved channel, the water-carved things don't ordinarily end in T's, do they? And this one over here, again, look how steep the walls are, how flat the bottom is. Craters are made by explosions, not by excavations. So ordinarily, their smooth bottom goes up to the rim, and you expect to see material on the outside. And you can't get a crater this elliptical by impact, even a grazing impact, because of the same reason. The crater is made by explosion, not excavation. And so you can get a slight ellipticity from a grazing impact because of the momentum of the explosion, but not something that elongated. So what formed it? So switching then to another category of images. This is called spots, tracks, and vegetation. Oops, sorry. Didn't mean to repeat that. Here is an area, this is a low-resolution view showing several craters, including this large one. This is where we'll focus our attention for the moment, because we have a high-resolution strip image here in the white box that came out across the desert floor, down the crater wall, and out over this this dark area here. Notice the weird dark shape here. Our strip image just samples that dark area here. And when we look at the high-resolution strip image, there is nothing to see in this part. It's just sand, some undulations in the sand, some small craters of no significance. Then it gets darker as you go down the wall of the crater. And you go out on the floor of the crater, and you come to this dark area, and what do we see in that dark area? We see this. This is just the end of that dark flow area on the floor of the crater. Very unusual formations, I'm sure you'll agree. Also, the suddenness with which they end the contrast of the white areas here, almost frost-like, and the black area. Many theories have been put forward to explain them. The vegetative one is doing well because, not this particular one, but some of the places where these spots are seen, they have now been photographed at different seasons, and indeed they grow in the spring, peak in the summer, fade away in the fall, and are mostly gone in the winter. Here's another place where we have spots in one of the winter seasons, and here is a place where we have spots in a summer season. This almost looks like it's melted at some point, and we have a flow feature. Here are some more spots. This feature is blown up in here so we can see it in high resolution. This is a completely different feature showing what looked like almost an organized field of triangular-looking spots. Maybe a different thing altogether. There are many places on Mars where there are tracks, and when we view them at high resolution, they look to be a bit more than just, as the going theory has it, dust devil tracks. There are even little, if you will, tread-like marks in the interior. It has been suggested that these represent the movement locations of machinery. We don't know what they are, but there is a curious tendency to clip to pass tangentially by the edges of craters. We see that repeated far more often than ought to be chance. Here are several of these tracks in a low-resolution view, showing that they go over long distances and roughly parallel one another. The little white box you see in there, right there, this track is shown in high resolution over here. And even though that was sort of a random point on this track to catch with the spacecraft, we see that, again, it's perfectly tangent to a crater where the track goes by. So these things don't seem to go randomly across the surface, but tangentially by craters. You can see that behavior in other places here, too. There are some other tracks, too, and a curious feature of these, besides their splitting and, in this case, right-angle bends, is that they're often accompanied by these spot-like or shrub-like things that are almost the reminiscent of the way we line our highways and roads with vegetation. That pattern is seen often. Here's another track or trail, and even more vegetative-looking stuff by the side. This vegetative pattern continues into larger forms. We see some here and here. Here it almost looks like structure within the vegetation, evidence of individual branches. And in fact, we see that certainly in looking at this object. It has a central trunk-like area branching from that. And most telling of all, since the original explanation thrown out for this was a crystalline structure on the ground, but these things cast shadows, indicating that they're well off the ground. In fact, this is perhaps a couple hundred meters across and maybe 80 meters above the ground. About this feature, it's so remarkably like what a tree would look like seen from above, that Arthur C. Clarke, the well-known science fiction author, gave this quote recently. "The recent discovery of life in the most improbable places, especially far down inside the Earth's crust, has now convinced me that we have been equally short-sighted. Some of the amazing images from the Mars Surveyor, especially the one we just saw, make me 95% sure that there are extensive areas of vegetation or its equivalent on Mars." In this section, let's see if I can get the title to come up. Yes, all right. Possible infrastructure remnants. I'll go through this quickly. These are alleged to be dust devil tracks, but there's also some little objects in here, and those are supposed to be boulders. But when you view them at high resolution, they tend to be rather rectangular. almost uniformly throughout this. It looks almost like structures or buildings, and interestingly, where the buildings cluster, the tracks intersect more often. It's very reminiscent of what archaeologists find on Earth when they're finding remnants of ancient civilizations. Here are layers of rectangular things at all scales, big things with little things on their backs and littler things on their backs and so on, many different scales. Here are instances of honeycomb-like patterns and other rectangular things. Here are things suggestive of large containers or enclosures, almost the way reservoirs would look on Earth if they were long abandoned. In fact, there are things that look almost like viaducts with tread marks across them, separating the various reservoirs, if you will. Here's a valley. Okay. A place with an area that's blown up over here has quite a few rectangular and high reflectivity objects within it. A field of triangles that are not at all randomly distributed, but tend to line up in arcs or curves, and then have linearity to them. It's been suggested those are obelisks casting shadows, but does that make them any less anomalous? Our second last section here is patterns and symbols. This contains a couple of interesting items I'd like to show you. Here is a view of a hexagonal crater, and in it we notice some interesting white stripes in the interior of the hexagonal crater, and happen to get a later view at higher resolution. It's almost as if that's where they wrote "Made on Mars." Notice these white striped things on the exterior too. Here are some objects that look very symbolic in character, as do these, but I'll show you the best example we have yet. This is the area right behind the D&M pyramid. Notice this V-shaped object and the dark markings right above. I've blown that up in higher magnification here. V-shaped object, dark markings. We see other dark markings over here. Concentrate on the dark markings. This almost looks like a capital B. This one looks like a P. This one looks like an A. This one looks like an F, possibly followed by an A. These are, I showed these because they're rather Romanesque. Some of the others are not at all recognizable or look like things from other alphabets, but there's a limited number of ways you can make alphabetic characters from a few lines and circles. This was the best we had without doing any tricks with the imagery, but one day someone was using a video camera and photographing my screen, and it showed the image much better, and we realized that the video camera, not having any thought at all to what was in the image, was using a noise filter to clean up what it thought was a noisy background, and when we did the same thing with the computer, it cleaned up the image nicely, showing that indeed the objects that look symbolic in character do show up rather distinctly from the background. The debate is obviously furious about whether or not these are real symbols or chance artifacts of nature, but obviously if they are symbols, then it's game, set, and match for artificiality. This section is about Lassie, stripes and tubes, and I'll just show you a few of these. When these are barely in contact with the surface, we see these parallel white stripes in many places on Mars, but wherever the surface is broken and fissured, we see what lies below, and it's these glassy tube-like objects. This one is shown in a blow-up over here. The white stripes are what we see on the surface, but they are glassy because faintly through them you can see that the stripes go all the way around, and they're translucent. You can see through them. This looks like a specular reflection of sunlight, which would mean that it's not natural materials but highly reflective materials. Here again you can see the glassy character and the striping character. There are many examples of these here, and these on a mesa at Cydonia, you can see that they cast shadows. Here they network. They're perpendicular here. They're seen in many sizes here. And in this instance, you can see the networking. There's one instance here where the white stripes go in one direction here and the opposite direction here. So there, we have a crosshatch pattern, which obviously shows that we can see through these things, and also that they're, it's very difficult for most natural formation mechanisms to make things that crisscross one another. Here is a case where the tube seems to be broken by this object, and this is a collapsed tube, and this is an intact tube that's severed at this point. This is an artist concept. Coloration always indicates artists have had a go at it. Artistic imagery, a very controversial area, as you might imagine. Here's a shape in context and cut out. Looks a bit like a seahorse. You'd say, well, that's pretty imaginative. But actually, it's from an area in which there is a kind of dividing line, like a watermark level. And above that, you see things like the stripes here, suggestive of a waterfall, of glaciers, of mountains, of a sky with stars in it. Things below look like aquatic things. There are many images suggestive of aquatic creatures, such as this dolphin. And they're all one of the things that suggests artificiality to these things, rather than just imagination, is their relationships to one another. They're organized. There's an aquatic area, there's an insect area, a mammal area, and so on. This is another object from one of those areas. This on the left is the original image, and on the right it's artistically enhanced to see what's there because it's very subtle. It's overblown with a lot of sand or dust. But notice that all those features are really there. It's very subtle, but what's interesting about it is that we only see one of these on all of Mars or in all of the solar system, and this object is located immediately adjacent to the face on Mars. There's also a female image there. It's as if there was an attempt to portray man, woman, and child. Again, context and relationships add to the story about artificiality. Here's another facial profile image, artistically enhanced over here with coloration. Yet another one. This one is rather amazing. Here's the artist's view to guide the eye. But over here is amazing detail and depth of detail. So detailed that over the eye there are actually 5 radial eyelashes. The closer you look with this, with a magnifying glass and a great computer image, the more amazing it becomes. And this also an image from Mars on the side of a hill. This image was photographed because there were some anomalous-looking building-like objects just off to one side. And we had no idea this was there. We just wanted to see what was in that direction because the building-like objects went off to one edge. And this is what we found in that direction. Now we come to the conclusions. And the conclusions will include speculations. Bear in mind, I've already given you the conclusion that we have artificiality established in one place, in my opinion, beyond a reasonable doubt. The formal odds are 1,000,000,000,000,000,000 to 1 against natural origin. But we have the case that that face object is hominid, not animal or alien or insect or amphibian or anything else it might well have been, but specifically hominid. Why us? And there's also a coincidence in the dating, because remember the line of reasoning that got us to locate it on the old equator that it had to be built before the last explosion, which by purely astronomical dating is 3.2 million years ago. What else is 3.2 million years ago? The oldest definitely hominid fossil on Earth of our species, the Lucy fossil. There have been some speculative findings older than that, but there's a lot of argument that they're really just ape and don't bridge the gap to humanoid. As nearly as we can date our humanoid line, our origins, we began 3.2 million years ago. As nearly as we can date the builder civilization, it ended 3.2 million years ago. That suggests the possibility that the parent planet explosion was anticipated, that there it would have produced a massive flood because the meteorites indicate that the parent planet was a water world, entirely habitable, that Mars was their moon, and so on, and suggests the possibility that Cydonia is in the category of what our moon will be, say, 1,000 or 10,000 years in the future when travel to the moon is unique. There will be lots of scientific and communications and exploration work on the surface wanting to attract funds. There will be tourists wanting to go to the moon. They'll first go to a space station, orbit the moon, get the overview. The places on the surface will learn to build attractions to attract the attention of those going over in the orbiters. And there's the possibility that that's the reason behind this kind of building on Mars. Theme parks, if you will, or museums of possibly of things on the Earth, possibly of the home world. One can't help but notice the resemblance to the most ancient traditions in all the ancient writings and all the cultures on Earth. Between this scenario, we're deriving purely from Mars imagery and astronomical lines of evidence, and this throwaway remark that Paul Davies noted that when you take away light and dark, the daily cycles, mammals, especially primates, tend to revert to a 24.9-hour day. And I end with Winston Churchill's quote, "Man will occasionally stumble over the truth, but most of the time he will pick himself up and continue." And the last slide shows references of where you can find out more about the story, including the website that has many of these images on them and the links to the original NASA images. Thank you very much.